Asia's IS Institute presenting current affairs for 17th October 2016. The first news item is BRICS meet declaration pledges to fight terror. So this is regarding the BRICS summit which was held recently in Goa. They have adopted the Goa declaration which talks on terrorism. So all international forms of terrorism, the financing of these terrorist camps, plus also about drug trafficking, about the sources of terrorism, plus terrorist centers being targeted, and also about international terrorist organizations like IS are specifically spoken of the using of internet, social media for propagating this terrorism, radicalization is also spoken of and targeted. So all these BRICS countries will come together and counter terrorism together. They have also spoken about the international terrorist organization IS specifically about the Syrian civil war, which should stop. But India's suggestion that including cross-border terrorism and including Pakistan specifically under this declaration did not take place because of lack of consensus, means all members did not agree. They have also spoken about CCIT, Comprehensive Convention on International Terrorism, which has been proposed by India at United Nations, should be adopted at the earliest. So that is the conclusion of BRICS summit and the Goa declaration. Then the next news item is SIT moves independent ED probe into money laundering. So SIT, Special Investigation Team on Black Money, has been set up, which is headed by Justice M.B. Shah. So now it has given a suggestion on money laundering. Money laundering basically means turning black money white. So all such cases are probed by ED, Enforcement Directorate, only when the case is filed by a state police unit or CBI or Income Tax Department. So now SIT is giving a suggestion that they should be allowed to independently probe such cases even if there is no case. Then the next news item is health spending, how states splurge on salaries. This is regarding the health expenditure which state governments incur. A major part of it is spent on giving salaries to the employees. So that is what this finding, a study which has been done on six states, finds out. Also, public expenditure is much lesser than private expenditure. But in outpatient department in Maharashtra specifically, OPD means patients just come, they do not get admitted, come and get their treatment done. That is much high in public sector than in private sector. The reason being given is that medicines are procured by the government, that medicine cost is very high. So if government procurement is done and market price medicines are not taken, then public health expenditure here in these cases will also be very low. And another thing which is highlighted and we already know is that OOP, out of pocket expenditure on healthcare, is very high. Means personally people have to spend on health rather than getting government support. So that is high. Then the next news item is telemedicine emerging as a growth driver in healthcare. So this is regarding telemedicine, means medication done through telephone or mobile services, which has penetrated even in the deeper parts of India presently. So that can be used for telemedicine, but it is also highlighted that bricks and mortar infrastructure is also required, means physical centers, clinics are also required. Only telemedicine cannot work. And also it speaks of medical tourism. Medical tourism means people from abroad coming to India to get medical facilities which are of good quality and cheap here. So that is medical tourism, for which again India is very famous, especially from Africa and Middle East, people do come here. Then the next news item is Center rethinks 40% NPS annuity order. So NPS is National Pension Scheme. So under the National Pension Scheme, it is mandated that at least 40% of the money which is withdrawn at the time of retirement has to be put into annuity. Annuity basically means schemes like pension schemes where you get monthly payments, assurance during retirement period. So 40% has to be invested in this. So this is resulting in not many people showing interest in NPS. So now there is a suggestion that this 40% limit, 40% mandate which is put on NPS can be eliminated or at least reduced. Pension Fund Regulatory and Development Authority, PFRDA, is considering this and giving suggestion to the center. But under PFRDA Act, it is mandated that after retirement, when money is withdrawn under NPS, then it has to be put into annuity. So that is compulsory, but what can be done is at least this percentage, 40%, can be reduced. Else, an amendment to the Act is required to completely eliminate this aspect. Then the next news item is overhaul steel policy, Niti Aayog Saraswat. So this is Niti Aayog member VK Saraswat who has given a suggestion that we need a completely new steel policy presently. The old policy is non-functional presently because of the issues the steel companies in India have faced. So the steel which is imported from countries like China, Japan and Korea have flooded the markets, and Indian steel manufacturers are suffering because this steel is cheaper compared to Indian, not in terms of cost, but cost plus addition of freight charges. Freight charges means transportation charges. So those are very high in India. So that is one point highlighted. Plus over this time phase since 2007-8. 2003-4 to 2007-8 is said to be the golden years for the steel sector when growth was very high, growth rate in steel industry. But then since 2007-8, because of cheap imports of steel, what has happened is Indian steel companies have suffered. They have incurred losses and they are also having a major chunk of the NPAs, non-performing assets in banks, which are because of these companies. Even the RBI came with strategic debt restructuring scheme under which the debt which is there can be restructured as equity. So that may result in even change in the setup of the company, the stock shareholders. But that has also not worked, is what VK Saraswat highlighted, because it has been used three times. Strategic debt restructuring scheme has been used three times and it's not working. So now he says there is an overhaul required so that a new policy can be brought up for steel industry. Then the next news is Maersk Line's charts new course to Alang for recycling ships. So Maersk Line is a company from Denmark. It is the largest container ship company in the world. It has now sought India, specifically Alang in Gujarat coast for ship breaking. So when ships are retired, they have to be recycled, they have to be dismantled, and maybe recycling can also be done, or at least they have to be disposed of. So all that takes place in these developing countries. China and Turkey were the regions where Maersk earlier sent its ships. Now it is planning to send them to Alang also. So Alang is well known for this ship breaking. It results in many contaminations also, asbestos contamination, which these workers here suffer from. But now Maersk Lines is saying that we'll not just use Alang, but we'll also invest in infrastructure here, we'll invest in better conditions being provided for workers, safeguards will be taken care of, all mandatory safeguards under International Maritime Organization, Hong Kong Convention would be taken care of. They will also provide housing facilities and construction for these workers at Alang. So they are speaking of bringing up better security and safeguard mechanisms after coming to Alang. So that is one thing. And the last news item, India rekindles bonds with Hungary. This we have already discussed yesterday also, and again it has come up in news. Vice President Hamid Ansari visiting Hungary, and there they have signed two agreements. One is on water management, another one is on economy, cooperation. So these two have been signed. So, and water management, because the Danube River which flows through Hungary, so they have expertise in water management which they can share with India. So that these are the items, 8 news items for today. Now we'll discuss some of them in detail as well. The first news item we've already seen, so Goa Declaration, Comprehensive Convention on International Terrorism should also be signed. So this is about, we've already seen this also, Comprehensive Convention on International Terrorism, which was proposed by India in 1996 at UN but has still not been adopted. So that is calling for universal definition of terrorism, ban on all groups regardless of country in which they operate, prosecution of cross-border terrorism. So our interest basically is in cross-border terrorism. So there's not much consensus. US allies have in the objections that on definition of terrorism. So there is no consensus on definition of terrorism also. Latin American countries have concern about humanitarian laws, because for tackling terrorism, laws are stringent. Then how human rights issues, how should they be taken care of? Then Organization of Islamic Conference countries, of course, they have concerns regarding Pakistan and Kashmir issue, Palestine issue. How will that be tackled? So those are the resistances. This has not been adopted at UN. Next, I spoke about this special investigation team. So the income declaration scheme which came up to resulted in good amount of money contribution for the budgeting also. So that is also there. This 4 month window which was given amnesty unilaterally declare your income so and not be prosecuted. Then health spending, this is about the health spending which has come up presently, that costs on inpatients, outpatients, costs on payment of salaries is very high. So they have considered some few states and they have seen the costs and compared it with public sector and private sector. Then the next news item on telemedicine, I discussed this, medical tourism and telemedicine. And 40% NPS annuity order, so they are considering removing that aspect. So this is about NPS and Employees Provident Fund. Employee Provident Fund was earlier there. Once national pension system has been adopted, they don't want Employees Provident Fund to be gone ahead with. So they are wanting people to enroll under NPS only. The reason being that this is EPF was a burden on the government. So those who are there under it still continue to be a burden because government has to give assured returns. Under national pension scheme now, the returns will be based on how you invest. So this is EPF versus NPS comparison to that, how much interest rate would you get. So these interest rates are common, but NPS, depending on whether you're targeting equity, investing in equity or in corporate bonds or government bonds, you will get returns accordingly, which may be high or low. So that reduces the burden on the government. And these, in another controversy which had happened was that NPS was made taxable. The withdrawal which is done under NPS is taxable and EPF is non-taxable. So, in under the recent budget, government had proposed that 40% of withdrawal from NPS would be tax exempt and remaining 60% would be taxable. They wanted the same thing for EPF also. EPF is 100% non-taxable, but they said 60% of it would be taxable. So, to bring both of them on par. So, this did not take place. That was not like that. What was non-taxable? Provident fund means people putting in money so that they can have a better future after retirement. That money on withdrawal is taxed. So that created a huge controversy. The government's intention was basically to bring NPS and EPF on par. But then under public pressure, they had to withdraw this provision under the budget. So that was there. Then the next news item about steel sector. This we saw that 25% sector's share in the banking system's NPS is 25% steel sector. And 2003-4 to 2007-8 was the golden years. Then RBI strategic debt restructuring scheme, which has been used 3 times, but then the scheme is working or not is not clear. So now a comprehensive steel sector policy is required, which will take into consideration everything, because steel sector is also a sector which has a long gestation period. Means if you invest here, the returns will come after a long time. So that is called long gestation period. That requires long-term financing. So how should that be done? So that is to be considered under a new steel policy. Then the next news item, because the present steel policy which is there, which was framed in 2012, which says the target is to raise capacity to 300 million tons by the year 2025. So it seems that this will not be met by just tinkering the present policy. So a complete overhaul is required. That is a Niti Aayog member's suggestion. This is regarding the debt restructuring, strategic debt restructuring scheme, that a joint lenders forum will be set up, which would meet to discuss recovery plans. Then they will decide how it can be converted into equity, and then if consent of at least 75% of creditors required, or at least 60% by number, 70% by value, and then a decision will be taken within 30 days. So that is strategic debt restructuring scheme of RBI. Then the next news item about Maersk, we discussed this. This is along the port in Gujarat. This is ship breaking which is done. And finally about Hungary, this we have discussed yesterday also. Again the same thing has come up. The 1956 revolution in Hungary, in which Indian government played a major role, Jawaharlal Nehru's intervention to talk to Soviet Union to have the pro-Soviet Union government not oppress the people, and even prisoners who were taken were released, who later one of the leader became the Prime Minister of Hungary too. So they appreciate India's role. And the 2 agreements on water management and on business cooperation. And this is the Danube River, which flows through these countries, Austria, Hungary. The President will also visit Austria now. So that is it for today. Thank you.